In this video, we're going to be looking at the Rhodophyta, the red algae. So that just basically means red plant. They, for the most part, appear red, and that's how they got their name. That's going to be due to their pigments. A really cool group of algae. Every time I learn about them, I learn something new and exciting. They have more marine species than all of the other groups of algae combined. They even have a bunch of cool parasites that parasitize other closely related red algae. So cool group to learn about, and I hope that you get to investigate more about them than just what we'll learn in this class. So let's look at what makes something a red algae or red alga. Their body plan, there's some unicellular, but most are multicellular. Multicellularity evolved multiple times. It's going to evolve in the red algae, it evolves in the green algae, and then all land plants are going to be multicellular. But throughout the tree of life, multicellularity evolves many separate times. So red algae will also have lost their flagella. So no red algal cells will have flagella, even though they're aquatic. Interesting. And the other thing that they have, something called pit connections or pit plugs. So in multicellular red algae, when they go through mitosis to make a new cell, there's incomplete cytokinesis and it leaves a hole in those cell walls that gets plugged up by some proteins. And so we'll look at a picture of what that looks like. Their environment, they're primarily marine. There are less than 100 freshwater species, and those freshwater species like don't even look like red algae. Some of them are green. So you can tell that they're red algae based on some of these other characteristics that we have in here. But the freshwater red algae are very strange. They have chlorophyll A, just like cyanobacteria, and phycobilins, just like cyanobacteria. And the phycobilin that they have the most of is phycoerythrin. And we learned about cyanobacteria and pigments. We learned that they are the blue-green algae because they have more phycocyanin as their phycobilin, whereas red algae are more red because they have this phycoerythrin. And that phycoerythrin allows them to get access to sunlight deep in the water column because it's those blue and green wavelengths of light that can penetrate deepest into water. So they're able to live. There's some coral and marine algae that live almost 900 feet deep in the water, which is pretty cool. Storage carbohydrate. We have Floridian starch. So that's this weird type of branch starch that looks a lot like glycogen, and it's just stored out in the cytosol. So that's important only because it's more similar to these ancestral lineages, more similar to like what glaucophytes do. Their cell walls have cellulose, just like plants, but they also have these compounds called galactins. And that makes them very slimy, so it's a way that they can slough off any like epiphytic stuff that's living on top of them, preventing them from getting sunlight. But it also allows them to have a high salt tolerance. So almost all of our marine algae have some sort of polysaccharide that has sulfates on it, like galactins, that allows them to be more salt tolerant. And the ones that we are kind of interested in for red algae is agar and carrageenan. Oh gosh, carrageenan. So agar we're using in petri plates. We're also using it maybe as a food additive. And then carrageenan we use as like an emulsifying stabilizer to help things that wouldn't normally dissolve together to stay together. And then life cycle is gonna be alternation of generations like plants. So haplodiplontic is another way to put that. Plus an extra diploid phase. So this is going to be one of the most complicated life cycles we learn. Oh, that says phase, maybe. So when we learned about alternation of generations in plants, we looked at that as a kind of mechanism to increase your survival by not just sending unicellular propagules out into the environment, but to have these organisms that would then make a bunch of those propagules for you. So we're looking at the same thing with red algae. They're mostly marine. They can live deep in the water column in this sort of vast expanse of ocean. So how do you increase your chances of fertilization? And when you do get fertilization, how do you maximize that? Here's a little review slide of what we just covered for the characteristics of red algae. So this is a picture of some pit connections or pit plugs. You can see them here. These are all connections between adjacent cells, and those can be formed during mitosis, so an incomplete cytokinesis, or they can be formed after mitosis where two cells meet together, like maybe even two different filaments of red algae, and then they fuse together with these secondary pit connections. These pictures show a diversity of red algal morphologies. In the bottom left, we see some unicellular red algae, and then the other pictures are multicellular red algae. And the one, actually both of those multicellular forms, those are Polysiphonia, and that's the one whose life cycle we're gonna learn. So we're gonna draw the Polysiphonia life cycle. I've hopefully removed my face from the screen so we have more space. So the first thing we're going to start with is four haploid spores. I'll draw some of these as purple and some of these as green. And as we know, because they're spores, they're going to grow by mitosis. And they're going to grow into multicellular haploid structures that look the same as each other. They'll have some differences when it comes to what they reproduce. So these are our gametophytes. And we'll have a male gametophyte and a female gametophyte. And we distinguish between male and female when we're talking about these organisms based on whether they produce a structure that is kind of retained or is larger, or whether they produce a structure that is smaller and released. So on our male gametophyte, if we zoom in on one of those branches, they make these pom-pom-like structures at the ends that produce a bunch of haploid spermatia. And that structure that makes spermatia is called the spermatangium. So that ending angium just means a vessel. So it makes spermatia, so it's a spermatangium. If we zoom in on one of the female gametophyte branches, this would be called a carpagonial branch. And what we'll see is this round structure with a thin tube coming off of it. So that round structure is called a carpagonium. And it has an egg inside. And this long tube coming off it is the trichogyne. And that is where spermatia are going to land and then travel down that trichogyne to fuse with the egg. So we'll have our trichogyne here, the egg at the bottom of the carpagonium, and a spermatium lands. And we get plasmogamy, and then its nucleus will travel down to the egg, and we get fertilization. So this fertilization happens on the female gametophyte. So we're looking at that carpogonial branch. There's the carpogonium. Now we have this fertilized egg. And actually, I'll make that egg a different color. We'll make it blue. Or how about orange, because that'll stand out more. So that egg that's been fertilized is our first diploid cell, which is always called the zygote. And that is going to develop on the female gametophyte into this complex structure. So we have our female gametophyte branch there in green, and a swelling of that female gametophyte branch called the pericarp. And so that is haploid. All this green stuff will still be haploid. Within the pericarp, we have this funny structure. So this is the carposporophyte. Sorry, I'm going to write over the female branch here. And some carposporangia. And those carposporangia are going to make carpospores, which are diploid by mitosis. So these are just clones of that first zygote, and they are going to go land somewhere and grow by mitosis, because they're spores, into another diploid structure. And so this one is independent of those other organisms. So a carpospore lands and it grows into a structure called the tetrasporophyte. And if we zoom in on one of those tetrasporophyte branches, they're divided up into these compartments, the cells, and within each of those cells, you'll have a tetrasporangium that undergoes meiosis to produce tetraspores. So the tetrasporangium is diploid, but once it undergoes meiosis, I should write that these are tetraspores. Those tetraspores are haploid. And that is our super complicated red algae life cycle. So we can review that process here. We have our gametophyte. So there's the male gametophyte right here, and that's making spermatangia at the ends of those branches. And each spermatangium is going to make a bunch of spermatia. And those spermatia will be released into the water, and hopefully somewhere in that big ocean, one will find a trichogyne. And that will fuse with the trichogyne, and the nucleus will travel down and fertilize the egg, which would be here at the base of that carpogonial branch. That will then grow by mitosis into the carposporophyte, which is inside of the female gametophyte tissue. So this is our female gametophyte still here, and we have made this structure around it. It's called the cystocarp, which we'll see in lab. And that cystocarp, the outside of it is the pericarp. And the pericarp is haploid because it's still part of the female gametophyte. All the tissue inside that is diploid because it grew from that zygote. So we have the carposporophyte here and the carposporangia here. That carposporophyte is going to make carpospores that it releases. Here's our little carpospores. They're diploid. They're going to land and grow into tetrasporophytes. So each of these can then be a new organism that undergoes meiosis and increases our genetic variation and survivability. So those carpospores land, they grow into a diploid tetrasporophyte, which has branches, and in each cell of those branches, it is going to have tetrasporangia that are diploid that then undergo meiosis to make four haploid tetraspores. And then each of those tetraspores can be released and grow into either a male or female gametophyte.